2.1 Cherry Tree by Ruskin Bond Part 3. Hello dear students and dear friends. In my last video lecture, I discussed and revised some of the important points of the poem Cherry Tree. I also read the poem and explained you the poem Cherry Tree line by line in detail. Friends, today too I will continue with the same poem, but today I will discuss the margin activities and the figures of speech used in this poem. First, we'll discuss the margin activities in the poem Cherry Tree, and afterwards I'll go for the figures of speech in this poem. So let's start with the margin activities first. So dear students, open your textbook of English and see on page number 66 and see the margin activities in the blue margin given beside the text, or you can also read it, you can also read this on the screen in front of you. Now see the first margin activity. The thought which prompted the poet to plant the cherry seed. Number one, then number two, then number three, and then number four. Now, the thought which prompted the poet to plant the cherry seed. Then number one, then number two, number three, number four. Here, these four points are nothing but the summary of this beginning of the poem. These four lines where you will have to fill up the information are nothing but the summary of the beginning of the poem, and it is the four stages of the early life of that cherry plant or cherry tree. I repeat, here in this first margin activity, you are given totally there are 5 points. Out of these 5 points or 5 sentences, one is already given to you as a clue, and rest of the 4 are the stages in the life of the cherry plant, or in the earlier life of the cherry plant, or the remaining 4 are the 4 stages of the early life of the cherry plant or the cherry tree. They are the summary of the beginning of this poem too. So let's discuss this activity and I tell you the answer. The thought which prompted the poet to plant the cherry seed. This first point is given. Then number one, the poet placed the seed, cherry seed, in the grass. The poet placed the cherry seed in the grass. Number two, he watered it once and forgot. Number three, the poet found a small 5 months old cherry tree. And number four, goats, the grass cutter's scythe, and the monsoon blight were a threat. So thus you will have to write these 4 sentences, which are the 4 stages in the early life of that cherry plant. So these are the four incidents that take place one by one in this poem in the beginning. Now let's go for the second margin activity. State whether the following statements are true or false. State whether the following statements are true or false. They destroyed the cherry tree. It is false. Cherry tree had an instinct to survive. It is true. Then the next one, the last one on this page. The blossoms are fragile. True. The blossoms are fragile. It is true. Now see on the next page. The margin activities on the next page. The poet felt richer because he had his own cherry tree at his door. Then the next one, the next activity. The last activity, of course. The beneficiaries of the cherry tree are. The beneficiaries of the cherry tree are. I tell you the answers. The finches. The bees. The moon moths. Singing crickets. And the poet himself. These are the beneficiaries of the cherry tree. Now friends, thus we have completed all the margin activities in this poem. Now let's start the discussion of the figures of speech from this poem and the lines of the poem. Now let me tell you first what is the figures of speech. Figures of speech is the figurative use of language. It is some sort of ornamental language that is used in writing. It is a different way of writing which expresses something more rather than the literal meaning of the words or the phrases. So, figures of speech means a figurative use of language in writing. It is a different way of writing which expresses the more than the literal meaning of the words or the phrases. It is the figures of speech which creates the greater effect and the writing becomes more and more effective just because of that figurative language. Because of that impressive language. So there are different figures of speech used in English language like simile, alliteration, repetition, personification, metaphor, climax, anticlimax, antithesis, onomatopoeia, inversion, hyperbole, synecdoche, etc. etc. But we will discuss those figures of speech which are there in our poems. Now, what type of questions will be asked on figures of speech? There will be two types of activities which are generally asked on figures of speech. Number one, you will be given two lines from the poem and you will be asked to identify and name the figures of speech used in the above lines each. for 2 marks. One line of the poem for 1 mark. 2 lines for 2 marks. This is a first type of question. Second type of question can be like this. You will be asked to explain the particular figure of speech. You will be given one figure of speech and you will be asked to explain that figure of speech and to find out another example of the same figure of speech from the given extract. So, thus, these various types of activities can be asked on figures of speech. But once you understand and practice it, friends, it becomes very easy. Now, let's start the discussion of the figures of speech from the poem. Now, see the second line. Since I placed my cherry seed in the grass, the figure of speech used in this line is alliteration. Now, how to write its explanation? Alliteration, underline dash. Then write here, the sound of S is repeated pleasingly. S is to be written into single united comma. Friends, keep in mind, alliteration is the repetition of the sound, consonant sound, of course, used in the beginning of the word. Alliteration is not the repetition of alphabets or letters. Understand this. You students usually create a mistake here. You write the letter S or alphabet S is repeated. This is completely wrong. In alliteration, letters or alphabets are not repeated. Sound represented by that letter or alphabet is repeated. So first understand that letters or alphabets and sounds are completely two different things. What is the differences or what are the differences between these two? Number one. Alphabets or letters means A, B, C, D up to Z, 26 alphabets. They are used in written form of language, written form of English language, while sounds are used in spoken form of language. This is first difference. Means sounds are used when we speak in English and letters or alphabets are used when we write in English. This is first difference. Second difference. In English language, there are only 26 alphabets or letters from A to Z. But there are 44 sounds in English language. Among these 44 sounds, some of the sounds are vowel sounds, pure vowels. Some of the sounds are diphthongs or vowel glides. And some of the sounds are consonant sounds. So, alliteration is the repetition of the consonant sound in the beginning of the word. For example, here in this line, second line, since I placed my cherry seed in the grass, in this line, the consonant sound of S, that is S. S sound is a consonant sound and it is repeated by alphabet S. So here, the sound of S is repeated pleasingly. So you have to write the explanation of alliteration in this way. Alliteration, underline dash. Here, the sound of S, put that small s into single united comma, is repeated pleasingly. So don't write the letter S is repeated pleasingly. If you write like this, alliteration and letter S is repeated pleasingly, then it is completely wrong. My friends, it is the murder of alliteration. So you can write like this. Here, the sound S or the sound represented by letter is repeated pleasingly. But you should not write only letters. So here in explanation of alliteration, sound, this word has to be used. This is very, very important word in the explanation of alliteration. Because alliteration is the repetition of consonant sound in the beginning of the word. Now there is another figure of speech which is just like alliteration, that is repetition. In repetition, the words are repeated in the same line of the poem as they are for emphasis. In repetition, the words are repeated in the line of the poem as they are for emphasis. And in alliteration, only sound is repeated. And in repetition, words themselves are repeated. So this is the difference between alliteration and repetition. So it is this line. Now see the next line. Fourth line. And watered it once and went to bed. Here in this line, the figure of speech is again alliteration. How to write its explanation? Alliteration, underline dash. Here, the sound of W is repeated pleasingly. Now see the next line. And suddenly, that summer near the end of May. And suddenly, that summer near the end of May. The figure of speech used in this line is also alliteration. How alliteration is there? Here the sound of S is repeated pleasingly. Now see the next line. I found a tree had come to stay. I found a tree had come to stay. In this line, the figure of speech used is personification. Now what is personification? In personification, non-living things or non-living objects or inanimate objects are given the human qualities. Here, the cherry tree is given the human quality of coming to stay. And so there is personification. Now see the next line. It was a very small 5 months child. The figure of speech used here in this line is metaphor. Now what is metaphor? Metaphor is a figure of speech in which an indirect comparison or implicit comparison is made without using the words like or as. There is another figure of speech which is just like metaphor but has a great difference, and that is simile. What is simile? Simile is the direct comparison between two similar objects with the help of the words like as, like, or as. So what are the differences between simile and metaphor? There are two major differences. Number one, simile is the direct comparison. Metaphor is indirect comparison. Second difference, in simile, the words like, as are used. In metaphor, no such words are used. And that's why it is indirect comparison. So see the sentence. It was, or see the line. It was very small, 5 months child. The figure of speech used in this line is metaphor. How metaphor is here? So here, the cherry tree is indirectly compared with the 5 months old child. Here, the cherry tree is indirectly compared with or compared to the 5 months old child. So there is metaphor. Now see the next line. The next line is lost in the tall grass. Lost in the tall grass, running wild. The figure of speech used in this line is personification. Lost in the tall grass, running wild. Here the figure of speech is personification. How? Here tall grass is given the human quality of running wildly. Now see the earlier line one more time. It was very small, 5 months child. In this line, there are two figures of speech. It was very small, 5 months child. In this line, there are two figures of speech. One is already discussed by us, that is metaphor. But one more is there, and that is antithesis. That is antithesis. What is antithesis? Anti means opposite. Thesis means ideas or concepts or notions. When in the line of the poem, two opposite words or two opposite ideas are used for the greater poetic effect, it is antithesis. Now in this line, two opposite words or ideas, small and tall, are used. So there is antithesis. Now how to write this explanation? Write the name of the figure of speech, antithesis, underline dash, and then write here, two opposite words or ideas, write the word ideas also, or ideas, small into single inverted comma, small, and tall into another single inverted comma, are used. Now after this, we discussed the line, lost in the tall grass running wild, personification. Now see the next line, the figure of speech in the next line. The next line is, the young tree struggle. The young tree struggled. Now here in this line, the figure of speech is personification. The young tree struggle. The figure of speech used in this line is personification. Here, the young tree is given the human quality of struggling. Now see the last line. Upward thrust its arms in a fresh, fierce lust. In this line, there are two figures of speech. There are two figures of speech. The first figure of speech is alliteration. The first figure of speech is alliteration. How alliteration is here? Here, the sound of F is repeated pleasingly. And in the same line, upward thrust its arms in a fresh, fierce lust, there is another figure of speech, and that is personification. How personification is there? Here, the young tree is given the human quality of thrusting arms and having fierce lust. So these are the figures of speech used in this poem on this page. See on the next page, we'll discuss the figures of speech on the next page. Now see the line, who watched wandering while time and tide and rain. In this line, the figure of speech used is alliteration. How alliteration is there? The alliteration is there because here the sound of W is repeated pleasingly. Now see the next line below it. Made a miracle from green growing pen. Here also alliteration. Here the sound of M is repeated pleasingly. Now see the next line. Spent a season in Kashmir. Spent a season in Kashmir. Again alliteration. Here the consonant sound of S is repeated pleasingly. Now see the next line. And I could scarcely believe it a berry. Again alliteration. Here the sound of B is repeated pleasingly. Now see the next part of the poem. The next part of the poem. Pink, fragile, quick to fall. Pink, fragile, quick to fall. The figure of speech used in this line is climax. Now what is climax? Climax is a figure of speech in which the words or the ideas are arranged in the ascending order of their importance. So this is what climax is. There is one more figure of speech which is exactly opposite of this, and that is anti-climax. Anti-climax means opposite to climax. Anti means opposite. Climax means the figures of speech named climax. So that figures of speech, that figure of speech which is exactly opposite of climax is anti-climax. So in anti-climax, the words or the ideas are arranged in or used in the descending order of their importance. Here in and here in climax, in the line of the poem, the words or ideas are arranged in the ascending order of their importance. So what is climax? Climax is a figure of speech in which the words or the ideas are arranged in the ascending order of importance. And what is anticlimax? Anticlimax is that figure of speech in which the words or the ideas are arranged in the descending order of their importance. Now here climax is there. Think fragile, quick to fall. Here the words or the ideas are arranged in the ascending order of their importance. Got it? Just you will have to write that much only. Climax, underline dash. Here the words or the ideas are arranged in the ascending order of their importance. Now the next figure of speech, next line. At the merest breath, the slippiest breeze. Again, alliteration. Here the consonant sound of B is repeated pleasingly. One more figure of speech is there in the same line, that is personification. How personification is here? Here, the breeze is given the human quality of being sleepiest. Now, so the next line, looking up through leaves at the blue. In this line, the figure of speech is alliteration. Here, the sound, consonant sound of L or consonant sound represented by L is repeated pleasingly. Now see the next line. Blind sky at the finches as they flew. Here again alliteration. Here the sound of F is repeated pleasingly. Now see the last figure of speech in this line. Swiftly and the stars turned in the sky. See the last fourth line. Swiftly and the stars turned in the sky. Again here is alliteration. Here also the consonant sound of S is used in the beginning of the words. So friends, thus we have discussed all the figures of speech in this poem. We should stop here. In my next video lecture, I will discuss the brainstorming section and the poetic appreciation of the poem. Thank you so much. Have a nice day.